We'll do it all. Everything on our own.
Well, they have sold more than 11 million records worldwide and are one of the world's most loved indie guitar bands. Gary from Snow Patrol, welcome to BPM.
Thank you very much. I didn't know we were loved, so that's very nice to hear.
You are very loved indeed.
Excellent. So I should forget what I hear on the internet.
That's very true. Thank you for coming to Australia as well. It's a long way from home for you. How are you enjoying your time here so far, and was the jet lag worth it?
Yeah, absolutely. It's funny because when we got in, I'd slept on both flights. We went to Singapore and then here. So I was feeling great. 5 o'clock in the morning, went for a run, walked around Sydney all day. Then the record label took us out for dinner at about 7 o'clock, and I fell asleep at the dinner table.
Oh, really?
So yeah, I thought I was like, no, brilliant. Not getting jet lag this time, and then like eating my soup, like, so had to be taken to the hotel, and I'm fine now. Slept a lot. It's all good. If I lay here, if I just lay here, would you lie?
Now, you're here, of course, to play some acoustic shows as part of the world tour for Fallen Empires. Mm-hmm. What can fans expect from those gigs?
Australia is getting acoustic gigs. You're the only country getting these gigs, you know. So it's the only way we could do it this year, to come here. And we came a little light without the rest of the guys. But yeah, we've been rehearsing a whole sort of new way to play some of the songs, and it'll be a very unique couple of gigs, you know. So it was either that or didn't get to come to Australia, and we weren't having that. No. You know, we love it here.
I'm happy to hear that. Yeah. Now, of course, speaking of Fallen Empires, your new record, it's a bit of an evolution, I suppose you could say, from your last couple of albums. Can you tell us about the new sound?
We wanted to put to the front, the forefront of the songs, a little bit more of the electronic kind of influences that we have always had, but they've always been lurking in the backgrounds like little ghosts. We wanted to make them into real people this time. And it's been a lot of fun. You know, we've pushed ourselves a lot. I mean, the title track, Fallen Empires, is certainly the most ambitious track we've ever made. There's a few things on there that you could shake a tail feather to, you know, for sure. But it's not like, you know, it got hailed, I suppose, in the British press anyway as our dance record. But it was soon found to be wanting in that department. It's still, you know, big songs and little songs, and then there's a few moments when, you know, you can dance around in your underwear if you want. Underwear optional.
What was the writing process like for this record?
Well, it was long. It was long. I had some writer's block. It took me a few months to get over. And then after that, it took us maybe 6 months to make the record. Normally it takes us 6 weeks to 10 weeks. So this was, you know, a lot more time. And I guess that was just because we were in LA, we were in Malibu, we were looking out at the Pacific Ocean, and maybe when we should have been working, we were watching the dolphins go past.
Lots going, of distractions.
Oh, shouldn't. It was just one of those things that it added to the sound of the record, and it added to the atmosphere in the record, but it also added to the length of the time that it took. You know, you can justify it up to a point. I hope our record label can justify it. And I don't think we'll be allowed to make another six month long extravaganza. Next time it'll have to be a little leaner.
And is there a song on the record that's your favourite or that's particularly meaningful to you?
I guess Lifening is particularly meaningful to me. Garden Rules, for sure. The song's written about my childhood and growing up in Northern Ireland, and songs written about my family and my friends, you know, all are going to mean a hell of a lot to me. Plus, it's kind of the first time I've talked about that. You know, I normally talk about relationships and not being particularly good at them. and in this record, I kind of, aside from the song New York, everything else is kind of about, which does tread some familiar ground. But the rest of the record is kind of about this new topic in our songwriting, which is, you know, home and I guess origin, and compared to where you are now.
If you were here beside me instead of in New York, in the arms you said you'd never leave, I'd tell you that it's simple and it was only ever thus. There is nowhere else that I belong.
Although I did read that you managed to have a bit of an Irish kind of feel to the writing, because I think you were hanging out in Joshua Tree.
Well, the rest of the guys were.
Right,
I was
okay.
Still in writer's block hell in LA, trapped in a cage of emotion, a glass cage of emotion, to quote Anchorman. The rest of the guys went to Joshua Tree to set up in the studio and play and rock it out a bit while I was sitting with an acoustic guitar, scratching my head.
How did you overcome writer's block? What did you do?
I actually hired Guy Garvey from Elbow to write. No,
I asked
a lot of people to how they got over it, because everyone goes through it,
yeah.
You know, and everyone had the same annoying answer, which is you've got to write your way out of it. There's no other way. You can't avoid it, and then suddenly one day, ha! It's like the way I think I can play the drums every time. Before I get to the drum kit, in my head I'm fine, I'm good, I can play the drums. And then I sit behind it, and then it sounds like a guy falling down the stairs with a drum kit attached to him, and it's awful. But it's just that moment you think, anything is achievable, you know, and that doesn't work with writing, as it doesn't work with drumming. So you've really got to just get in there and relearn almost how to write. You know, I wrote pages and pages of nonsense, and I hope I don't die without having burned those books, because people might go, oh, here's all his notebooks, let's have a look at them, and it's just like
these amazing songs I haven't heard yet.
Gibberish, like it was written by semi-intelligent spiders. But it just took its time. I had to write the madness out.
You've been up all night and the night before, and you've lost count of drinks and time.
From a live point of view, how are audiences reacting to the new music?
Really well, actually. Right from, even before when the album was released, we were playing some new songs in the set, and which is always slightly dangerous, and you always feel like you've got to get the balance right. You don't want to be self-indulgent.
Yeah.
You can't like play the whole album. Everybody's just sitting there going, make it stop. And so we dropped three or four songs in every now and again, just coming up to the album release, and they were going down really well, and now they're, I mean, all over Europe, things are going really well with that record. But it's interesting. It's been interesting to see the atmosphere changes when playing them acoustically. We've not done that to a big crowd before. You know, normally our acoustic sessions are to like 50 people. You know, this is, we're playing in sort of
thousands.
Nice theatres.
Yeah.
So this will be a very different experience for us.
Is it true that I should now be calling you Dr. Gary Lightbody?
No, that isn't true.
Okay.
But I am Dr. Gary Lightbody.
Right.
But you shouldn't call me that. My mom and dad are from Derry and the University of Ulster in Derry in Northern Ireland. Gave me an honorary doctorate. For reasons best known to them, but they it was an amazing day. You know, the campus is about 200 yards from where my grandmother used to live, and my mum grew up, you know, and, you know, God rest her soul, she's not with us anymore, and it meant the world to my mum and dad. You know, it was like it was a really big day for us, and it was one of those lovely days spent with the family, and I had to stand up and make a rather nervous speech.
How did you go with that?
Well, I'd written a speech, and then I went, nah, I'm just going to stand up and say things.
Good.
Luckily, I didn't, you know, just have a writer's block then. That would have been a really bad time to have it.
I want so much to open your eyes, cause I need you to look into mine. Tell me that you
You're well known for giving back to kind of your roots and supporting kind of local bands. What's the local music scene like in Ireland at the moment?
In Ireland, all over Ireland, it's amazing. In Northern Ireland specifically, it's as good as it's ever been. You know, the Republic of Ireland have always had a strong tradition of great bands. You know, for eons, not just decades. But with Northern Ireland, the music scene's always been a little bit more disparate, a little more sporadic, and not really a scene. But now, over the last 5 years, I mean, stemming from Peace in Northern Ireland, sort of in the late 90s, and all the way through now, you know, it's allowed us to build an infrastructure, cottage industries. So there's, instead of having to go to London or Glasgow, where we had to go when we were starting, there's like record labels, management labels, production companies, places to rehearse, places to record, places to loads and loads of places to play. There's like, you know, in Belfast it used to be you'd be lucky if there was a gig every week. Now there's like many gigs every night, you know. With our rain-washed history. Yeah, we were involved in the Oh Yeah Music Centre, setting that up. It was our idea, and we were very proud to say that it's flourishing now, you know, and as heavily involved as I can be with lots of bands, you know. There's so many great bands. I mean, great bands like The Wonder Villains and Plastic Rose and David C. Clements is a great artist. Just amazing bands. Could continue on forever, but if anybody wants to check out bands in Northern Ireland, just go to the Oh Yeah website, or go to Third Bar, or just go online.
Well, kind of speaking of up and coming bands like that, and kind of just finally, it's very hard to break into the music industry for a lot of bands, despite how great they are. It can be a really hard slog. What's your advice to bands out there to kind of keep going and stay motivated and try and find success?
Well, the funny thing is that everybody, there's this new culture over the last decade or so of self-sufficiency that the bands know more now than maybe I do from all my years in the music industry, of just doing it themselves, you know. Knowing that gigs is the most important thing, all just going out finding gigs, begging for gigs, going and doing anything that they can get their hands on just to get better. Managing themselves or finding a young, keen manager, getting a record out, putting it out themselves. You know, I mean, that's what we try and help with Third Bar and with the Oh Yeah Centre, is try and put the right bands with the right people.
Yeah.
But it is, it's amazing how that they all kind of have learned all these techniques that it took us years and years of learning, and we kind of just were waiting for other people to do it for us.
Yeah.
You know, and no one's waiting around anymore. They're not. I mean, we had 10 years of no hits, but plus that can't happen anymore. You've got to get out there fast.
Yeah.
You know, you can't sit around for 10 years and wait for success. You have to grab it by the scruff. Most of these bands are doing that, but that's why we set up these things, is to help bands avoid the pitfalls that we fell into every single one of them, kind of Spinal Tap-esque.
Yeah.
in our early career.
Anvil.
Yeah. You know, I mean, you know, and it's important that it's important to maintain that enthusiasm and that drive and that self-belief, you know, that all these young bands have. They're so goddamn cocky, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
And you never lose that, you know.
Yeah.
As long as you've got a bit of heart as well, that's fine.
Yeah, for
just
sure.
Just cockiness is fine, as long as you don't turn it into arrogance, you know.
And also, well, speaking of brilliance, you can actually download Fallen Empires at bigpondmusic or stream via Mog. I highly recommend it, it's a great record. Gary Lightbody from Snow Patrol, thank you so much, great to speak with you.
Thanks for having me.
Pleasure.